Thank you, everybody. So one of the things that's interesting about selling to a lot of customers across different industries is you get a lot of different perspectives when it comes to how people run applications in IT. And most companies look at IT as something that they have to run in order to keep their lights on. They do understand and acknowledge that applications can be strategic. But what companies are waking up to find is that you can get disrupted in almost any industry, and that applications are becoming more and more important to the core of a business. And so today I want to talk a little bit about my lessons learned in building applications, assembling great teams, how do you find innovation, how do you refine innovation, how do you pick the things that you want to invest in, apply not only for Delphix, but within your own organizations. So the taxi industry. This is a long-standing old industry. Everybody knows where I'm going to go with this, but think about it just broadly across all industries. You would never think that applications could disrupt the taxi industry. Long-standing business, it's been around forever, lots of regulations, lots of geographical concerns, and yet a single application can have a massive impact on this long-standing industry. Let's take another example. Thermostats, they're not particularly glamorous. You wouldn't think there would be that much innovation or opportunity to build devices and applications around thermostats. How could you get to $1 billion in revenue against companies like Honeywell? And yet, if you build the right products, you tie them in with the right application suite, you can disrupt this very stodgy old industry with new technology and applications. The changes are happening even faster. So, a couple years ago, we all used to go to the Blockbuster store, wander around the aisles, pick our movies, finally take them home and watch them. You had Netflix drive a huge transformation in the industry where they started shipping them by mail. And yet, even that wasn't enough. So the rate of innovation is accelerating. Today, Netflix itself has created its own disruption. Even if you're innovating, the seeds of your own destruction can be part and parcel of how you're operating, or the core of where the industry is headed. And so you have to make sure that you can innovate at the speed that the market is innovating, or faster. So where does innovation come from? There's a lot of debate about product vision versus customer feedback. And there are a lot of companies that truly believe that, you know, what you need to do is you need to find ideas and you just keep iterating by talking to customers, talking to partners. That is certainly one way that companies in Silicon Valley have been built. It's a very expensive way to build innovation, and it ends up with low probability odds of success. And there's this quote attributed to Henry Ford. If he'd asked customers what they wanted, they would have wanted a faster horse. But in fact, what they really needed was a car. Sometimes the innovation, you cannot surface it by talking to customers, talking to constituents, talking to users. It's really going to be a single moment of product vision that defines the course of what will happen over the course of the next year, 3 years, 5 years, or even a decade out. Now, if you don't have anybody with great product vision, if you don't have people who can define products that are going to be great products and will really work inside of your organization or work inside of your market, if you don't have that, then you must iterate your way there. So the key within your organizations, everybody has innovative talent within their organizations. It's really to spot the repeat innovators. And there's a challenge with innovation. There are a lot of people who generate great ideas that aren't clear or executable ideas. Those are pretty much just worthless. They're just noise in the overall system. So what you're looking for are people who can repeatedly innovate. Individuals within your organization have great ideas. They can sell around them, gather teams, bring them to life, execute them, make a change. For those individuals, you just want to tap them on the shoulder and give them a little bit more power in the org. And you really want to spot these repeat innovators until you can find the ones who can revolutionize your organizations from within. So my first software company was a company called Avamar. Back in 1999, when I started Avamar, almost everybody backed up the same data over and over again onto tapes. And the tape backup industry was a terrible industry that had like 70% success rates for backup and restore. And tape media is a very difficult media to work with. I just think about the days when we used to use VHS and Betamax tapes in order to watch movies. If you want to get to a specific place or you want to switch a movie, it's all a hassle. It's so physical, time-consuming. It's difficult to get to the exact point of the movie that you want to see. And what happened was in 99, there were a bunch of consumer products that came out into the market. TiVo just shipped, and MP3 players were all over the place. Now, they were applying these concepts of lossless compression to things like movies and to audio. And my idea at the time was, well, if you could apply the same general concept to this data protection industry, this take-backup industry, you should be able to change this industry. And there were a couple other things that were happening at that time. Disk was plummeting on a per gigabyte cost versus tape, so the fundamental economics of that industry were shifting in the direction of disk. And so the idea for me was, if we could eliminate all this redundant data and pack it down more efficiently that enterprises use to back up their same data over and over again every single week, you should be able to change a pretty large industry. At the time, the backup industry was roughly a $4 billion industry. And that's exactly what happened over the course of about a decade. So today, data deduplication is roughly half of the entire backup market, around $5 billion of the hardware, software, maybe $8 to $10 billion market. One of the things that happens is, you know, you get the idea for a product. Like with Avamar, I had the idea very early on. I wrote up all the product requirements for the product. You're not going to get everything right. You're not trying to get everything right. You just need to have enough vision to know where you're headed. And then from that point on, you will iterate a great deal. That doesn't mean you're shifting and pivoting and changing your model or changing your product. It's just adding on all the micro inventions, all the subtle differentiators that can allow your product to be better than competitors that might follow you into the market or that might be already on their way into the market. And it's kind of a funny thing because when I first started Avamar, I didn't have that crisp of an idea of how to frame the business, how we would go to market. And so the first couple times I went and pitched to VCs, and I pitched a lot of them, I started Avamar in Southern California, down in Orange County where the weather is warmer, the beaches are brighter. And the funny thing is you have a lot of lower tier VCs in Southern California compared to the ones up here in the Bay Area. And because I had less of a sense of the overall business that encapsulated the product, I actually failed in all my first attempts to get funded. I pitched a bunch of VCs in Southern California and got passed by all of them. And over the course of really learning about how they looked at the business and the product within the context of that business, I was able to refine that pitch, get a clear understanding of the business. And by the time I actually got audiences with five of the top 10 VCs in Silicon Valley, I ended up with term sheets from three. So the top of the pyramid I was able to get term sheets from, but not the bottom. When you think about it within your own organization, what you can apply to it is, if you have a great idea, if you know that the entire industry or some part of your business is heading in one direction, and you can see clearly the core of that, you might have to iterate around that. You might have to change your sales pitch, understand how to bring people together, how to assemble teams, how to win the politics within your organization. It's worth that battle and that refinement. If you go to Florence, if you go to the Uffizi Gallery, they have these statues that are mostly just block statues. They're still in stone. You can see it on the far left here. And you can just see that the sculptor, Michelangelo in this case, is finding the statue, finding the shape of it from that rough block. Now, the key thing to know is whether or not you have the block of marble that has inside of it a David or a Pietà, and then you have to refine it over time in order to really deliver the great product that you want, or the great innovation you want to bring to market. And then what you have to be very careful is not to lop off. You can lop off an arm and it'll still be a masterpiece, but you can't lop off the head, for instance. So you have to know, exactly what you're doing in refining and building that product over time. But it is a serial amount of creation. The idea is you have to have a clear vision of where it's going and then work for it over that period of time. There are a couple things that I look for in starting companies. So, after Avamar, I had to decide, did I want to stay with EMC? EMC acquired Avamar in 2006. They've done a couple $1 billion in sales with the product. I had to decide whether or not I wanted to stay at a big company with all the resources of a big company, or to go out and start a new company. And so one of the things you want to do is really have a good rationale in terms of how do you qualify what is good innovation, what is worth pursuing. And I'm going to talk about it in terms of starting companies, but you can apply a similar kind of rubric to innovation that you might greenlight within your organization. When it comes to starting a company in the enterprise technology space, the number one thing that you look for is market size. Markets are very hard to create. They're even hard to disrupt if they exist. But market size is ultimately the ceiling in which your idea will grow. If it's a low ceiling, it's a $100 million annual ceiling. That's as big of a revenue base as you will grow, and it defines the size of your opportunity once you've divided market share across any competitors. So you really want to understand the size of the market. And when I was deciding whether or not I was going to leave EMT, you know, I wanted to make sure if I was going to go, I was going to start a company in a massive market, a much bigger market, ideally, than the data protection market. Product fit. So a lot of people have probably read the blogs about product market fit. It's really important for you to get the exact right fit of your product within a market. And that means having the right feature set, addressing all the right requirements. It encompasses delivering at the quality that's required to be able to move and scale within a market. But I think the one big thing that a lot of companies overlook and that a lot of people overlook when they're trying to drive internal innovation or changes is what's the degree of value differentiation? And today, the technology world is changing so rapidly. The chessboard evolves so quickly that there are new lanes emerging all the time. So there's no reason to sign up for new projects or innovation that give you micro returns that have 2, 3, 5, 10% differences. Although those differences have defined number one versus number two and three in a lot of very mature markets. But when it comes to technology, you can actually find 5x differentiation, 10x differentiation, or even 100x differentiation. And so you really want to look for value differentials that are very large, ideally in the 100x category. At Avamar, when it came to taking all the backup data everybody used to put onto tapes and packing it down into disks, we could take daily backup sets and shrink them by 300x, so there's 100x return on the amount of data we could collapse just by using smarter software and packing on disk instead of using an old antiquated media. And then the final two pieces is you've got to assemble the right team and you've got to execute. And even within your own organizations, if you are having teams that are working on innovative projects, they're selling in order to gather their teams. They're selling within the broader organization to get the resources that they need. And so they have to build those teams and they have to execute, and you need to foster a culture that enables that. So in the end, we made a lot of mistakes at Avamar. We helped build a really big industry, but we ended up selling the company for $165 million just before the market really took off. And we had a competitor in the market that started up here in the Bay Area called Data Domain. I founded Avamar in 1999. They followed us in 2001. They hired a better team than we did in the Bay Area than we could find in Southern California. And they wiped out our lead in the market from a technical perspective. So the first big lesson that I learned was talent comes first. You need to have the most talented people you can possibly find manning the innovation that matters to you. Because that is ultimately the magnifying effect, the accelerant on all of the efforts that come after it. And I realized that if you can't, in Southern California, there aren't that many public software companies or enterprise technology companies, and a lot of them have disappeared over time. So there's not a very big talent pool. There used to be Quest Software down there, but they've now been swallowed up by Dell. So in terms of enterprise software, not a lot to choose from. And so we actually hired people from all kinds of different walks of life who hadn't shipped big enterprise products to thousands of customers and seen the quality tail that's required in order to support those customers in the field. And that's what really crippled our ability to get the product to a state where we could start rolling out in the field and allowed a competitor to follow in 2 years later and effectively catch us in the market at the same time with a product of equal quality. In Silicon Valley, they almost grow in trees. If you just drive up 101, 280, and through a lot of the main cities, there are so many big companies, six of the top 10 technology companies inside of a 15-mile radius, maybe half of the 50 biggest technology companies. So I decided that if you can't get the talent to move to you, move to the talent. But I have a philosophy at Delphix. It's talent first, regardless of location. We want the kingpin developers, architects, founders of products that can really make a difference, and we've assembled that kind of team. Once you assemble enough of them at the top, and that becomes the quality bar, it gets easier and easier to stack the rest of the team at that quality bar. So it's not just the first one, it's the cluster right at the top that matters the most for setting and maintaining the bar. So if you have an innovative new project, you know, you want to take your best first person, but you also want the second and maybe the third, and then the rest will just come with it. They'll bounce everybody else out of the out of their overall program and their efforts that don't fit within that set of quality individuals. The second big thing I learned was respect complexity. Really ship that minimum viable product that gets bandied about quite a bit. So at Avamar, when and I didn't have a lot of experience at the time in shipping software products. I had been an English major in college, which makes perfect sense into building new technology products and companies. But in any case, we were building this deduplicating file system that stripped out redundant data from tapes and packed it onto disk. And one of our engineers had this idea. He said, hey, you know, we could build in this thing called, that I call RAIN, redundant array of independent nodes. It's a clustering technology underneath this deduplicating file system. So that if you had a grid of these Avamar servers, you could keep adding them when you needed to scale, you could take them out, and the overall system would be resilient. It's like RAIN, but across the server nodes of our deployments. And it sounded great. It sounded like, of course you want this, because you want to be able to scale an enterprise organization. You want to be able to keep your backups and your stores running. It turns out that the RAIN component itself is really what cost us all of the early development time. It took us almost 4 years to get that to a production state where we could ship it, get customers up and running, and keep it maintained. And Data Domain, the company that followed us in the market, didn't even bother building it. They didn't even have redundancy. If it failed, it just failed. But they were able to back up the data. And the reality is that backup products were failing all the time anyway, so it wasn't necessary in the market. At Delphix, I realized that when we were going to start a new company, I wanted to make sure we got the product out to market as quickly as possible. From the point that we started hiring the high caliber team that we could find in Silicon Valley, we shipped the product within a single year. We were a quarter early as opposed to 3.5 years late in getting a product out to market. And then you really need to make sure you have compelling vision and goals. Everybody's heard about the big hairy ass goal. At Delphix, our goal is to eat all the data. We want to consume all the enterprise, all the high asset value data into our engines to really free that data for application projects and accelerate time to market for our customers. But you need to make sure you have a big enough goal that's exciting and motivating, because it's part of the sales effort of assembling teams, keeping teams motivated, getting through all the hard times and always that you always have to go through in order to deliver a new product or innovation. Alright, so today companies are rolling out all these application projects. And data is like the gas that you pour into your application projects. If you have low quality data or it takes forever for you to get the data into your different environments, it's going to destroy your effectiveness, your competitiveness, the time to market for your organizations and your investment. And so with Delphix, what we do is we help companies, we revolutionize the way you deliver data. So we can deliver data into a development test, reporting, training, staging environment 100 times faster, sometimes 1,000 times faster than standard methods today. So usually it's like a request chain of, we call it the bucket brigade of DBA, sysadmin, storage admin, backup admin. It's all working to get the right files and databases into the right development environments or QA environments for somebody to finally do their work. With Delphix, it becomes automatic, it's virtualized, so we can literally deliver it self-service and in minutes. And that results in taking out all the wait time environments. You get way more effective environments for every project. And it's helped our customers roll out their projects in half the time. Today, you're investing in tons of these application projects that are material to your business. Most of them are just sitting around stuck in traffic. If you can just take out all the wait time and all the delays, you can get far more acceleration in those programs than you would probably assume. And application projects are constrained by all kinds of data movement. So in general, we help companies with these three categories: buy, build, and move. Buy is all the ERP applications, CRP rollouts, CRM rollouts. We help companies with SAP and Oracle EBS and PeopleSoft and their e-commerce suites. Build is all the application development. We help a lot of our customers with rolling out, you know, faster apps for their core business driving applications like Xfinity Development and Comcast, like many of the eBay properties and stuff Upside uses us to roll out faster releases, and even companies like Walmart. So, and then move. A lot of companies right now are trying to get agility by moving to private clouds and into public clouds, where you can get faster turns and faster access to environments. We're helping accelerate those programs by 50%. In all of these kind of projects, you have to move data from existing production applications into development and testing and rehearsal and validation environment. So environments and data delivery are bottlenecked in all of those programs. The key thing for us is we wanted to go after a market that had a huge amount of pain that we could solve. And data delivery today, as I talked about it, it's a chain of people. It's like going to Blockbuster and then waiting at the counter and then finally slowly driving back home to watch a movie. It takes this chain of people, DBAs and sysadmins and storage admins. I had one of our customers tell us that to get a single integrated test environment up and running, they had over 300 IT tickets that had to get turned over in order for them to get the exact right environment up for development and testing. And if you make a environment down to minutes, and it can be handled by a single team, a single developer or QA engineer can simply click a couple buttons and they've got their entire environment back up and running with the exact data they need to perform their function in that project. There are a couple of major CIO priorities today. This is from Gartner. They recently did a survey. The top three CIO priorities today in the data center are, they're all actually related. So you look at number one, companies are looking for this private-public hybrid cloud strategy. One of the biggest concerns that companies have is they don't want to get locked into a single hypervisor or into a single cloud. So you want to make sure you're picking the right future state. And then there are two associated, the next two biggest priorities are also associated with this move into the cloud. So if you look at the one directly beneath it, beneath developing a private-public hybrid cloud strategy, you can't move your Unix applications into the cloud. You can't move things from AIX or HPUX or Solaris. You've got to convert them to x86 first. So that's a bottleneck to getting to the cloud. And then also a lot of the backup and DR solutions that companies have, if you've got Data Domain or Avamar appliances sitting in your data center or you're using EMC SRDF, you know, they're not going to port into Amazon Web Services. So you have to rethink all of your strategies around migrating to the cloud. The way we look at it at Delphix is 80% of the applications are still sitting in the enterprise in legacy systems, legacy data centers. And what we do is we really break the lock-in of data and help accelerate its movement into private and public cloud. So if you take a little step back and you think about what server virtualization did to it. So hypervisors, they basically slide between server hardware and operating systems and have this commoditizing, accelerating effect on both, right? Both above and below. And they've also enabled the cloud. What we do is, with data as a service, what we do is we slide between storage, so the hardware that's containing these databases and data sets, and databases and applications. And because we can non-disruptively break out the data into our engines and then feed them into development, test, and rehearsal or cutover environments, we can radically shrink the time it takes to get into a private cloud or get into a public cloud. We recently, just today, we announced that we acquired a masking company that allows us to eliminate sensitive customer information before we deliver these data sets into private or public clouds. So you can now even burst dev test into these environments without compromising data security. And it's our belief that as you roll forward a couple of years, data as a service, we believe, will become a permanent layer in the modern stack. Today, there are a lot of companies that provide IaaS, or platform as a service, but if I give you a development environment or I give you a VM and you're a part of an application project, you can't really do your work until you have the right data inside it. It's a little like if I gave you a laptop and I had an Outlook installed and I had the Office Suite installed, but I don't have your emails in it, I don't have your files in it, you can't really do your work unless you put the exact, precise, right data for the right team into the environment. And so what data as a service does is we fill the yolk inside of these container shells. One of the interesting things in another Gartner study recently is they've shown that all the big vendors who really sit around the table today and help companies set their strategy, on a secular basis, they're all losing their priority or their influence at the table. And think about some of these companies like EMC or NetApp, who the bulk of their business is hardware that they're selling to the data center. Many of these companies don't have legitimate strategies for transitioning the body of their sales and revenue into a cloud world. And you can see that hybrid public cloud is coming. There's no way of avoiding it. These are the dinosaurs that rule the earth today. But the cloud is coming, and it's accelerating with technologies that can break lock-in like Delphix. All right, we've got a handful of minutes for questions, so I'll open it up to the room.